Welcome, church. We are so glad that you've decided to join us for worship this morning, and we look forward to engaging God together today. As part of our service, we've included some resources that we've made available to you so that you can get the most out of your experience with us. The first is a service bulletin and sermon fill-in that has been made available on our website, HoustonUMC.com, and we also included a PDF copy of the file in an attachment that you received with a link to this service. We encourage you to pull that up on a tablet or print it off so that you can use it to follow along with the service. It's got the lyrics to the songs and even a sermon fill-in for you to help you track as we go throughout our time together today. The second thing is that we would like to ask that you fill out an online communication card for us. It's really the only way that we know who watches the service, and it makes it easier to care for you as we go throughout the week. You'll find a link to that both in the video description and in the email that we sent out before this service with the link. We also finally want to encourage you to interact with the service as best you can. It really helps if you can put the service on a TV, but if you're watching from a tablet or a smartphone today, we understand, and we're just glad to have you with us. We, like I said, encourage you to print out the bulletin, use it to follow along. We encourage you to sing. We encourage you to shout amen and to engage with the sermon as the Spirit moves you. Our call to worship this morning comes from Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, and it says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice." Join me in prayer for our time. Lord of love and light, shine through our darkness, bringing us hope. Open our hearts for the journey, our eyes for the light, our spirits for the peace which you will bring. Fill our mouths with laughter and speech with shouts of joy, that we shall reveal the love with which you surround us. We offer this prayer in the name of the one who is coming into the world, bringing you hope, love, peace, and joy. Jesus Christ. Amen. And now we welcome Susan Williams to light the third candle on our Advent wreath as we reflect on the theme of joy.
Today marks the third Sunday of Advent, a special season of the year when Christians eagerly look toward the coming of the Christ at Christmas. It runs for 4 weeks, and each week we light a candle on this Advent wreath and turn our attention to a specific theme surrounding the coming of Christ. The first 2 weeks celebrated hope and repentance. Today's candle, the pink one, celebrates joy. Isaiah 35, verse 10 states, "And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will be upon their heads, and they shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away." We light this candle as a symbol of Christ, our joy. May the joyful promise of your presence, O God, make us rejoice in our hope of salvation. O come, Emmanuel. Now please join me in singing the first verse of "Come Thou Long Expected Jesus."
Oh,
Today's scripture is from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. For to us a child is born, but there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I hope you have received and had a chance to peruse our latest church newsletter that was mailed out to you this week. There is some useful info in there for you, but what I really hope is that you saw something that brings you some joy. If you're still not sure what I'm hinting at, let me just be straightforward with you. We will have a real, live, in-person Christmas Eve service here at Houston United Methodist Church. Yep, you heard that right. For the first time in 9 months and for my first time as your pastor, we are going to have a live and in-person service. Even right now, standing before you on this screen, that thought gives me an immense amount of joy. It gives me joy because you all will get to see each other's faces for the first time in a while. It gives me joy as I consider the opportunity of getting to share a Christmas message with you in person. And it's a message that I hope speaks of the hope and peace and joy and love that can enter your life as a result of what took place on that silent night. It gives me pleasure to know that we will have the opportunity this year to all sing Silent Night together as we light our candles and gradually spread light amidst the physical darkness outside, but also amid the figurative darkness that has overshadowed our lives for the last 9 months. It's going to be a joyous time, and I hope that you can make plans to join us on December 24th. You know, as I think about this opportunity, it gives me chills because it's almost as if God is using this opportunity to offer us a real but symbolic example of a truth that we all need in our lives right now. He is showing us light in a very dark time. He is showing us that even in the middle of all the pain, sadness, frustration, disappointment, and even anger that saturates our lives right now, that He, God, is still capable of offering us relief. He is still capable of providing an opportunity for joy. I don't know about you, but I think we could all use a little bit of joy in our lives right now. If the last 9 months have shown us, and by us, I mean the entire world, anything, it's shown us that we live in a dark world that with the snap of two fingers is capable of ridding our lives of even the most basic forms of joy. We used to be able to find joy as we gathered around a table with friends and with food and with family. But not in 2020. We used to be able to find joy in community activities that allowed us to develop relationships with others, things like Bible studies or exercise classes or even book clubs. But again, not in 2020. We used to even find joy in connecting with others on Sunday mornings. But even then, not in 2020. No wonder we feel lost. No wonder we feel frustrated. Even though we recognize that there is a problem, we recognize that we need joy in our lives. Many of the strategies we would use to facilitate that, to bring that into our life, to bring light into our life, have been stripped away from us. And I think where we're at in our lives right now is as good a time as any to consider this question. Maybe we've been seeking light in darkness, seeking joy in mourning, from all of the wrong places to begin with. And here's why I say that. You know, the Bible tells us, and observing Advent even reiterates for us, that we can have joy because God has revealed to us a light capable of conquering any darkness. Throughout the Bible, we see the illustration of light overcoming darkness. In Genesis, we read that the first thing God created in our world was light to extinguish the darkness. And we've talked about how in Exodus, God was present among his people as a pillar of fire, providing a light source as they crossed the dark wilderness to the promised land. Many of us consider the greatest truth in this analogy to be when Jesus, the man who many of us believe to be God in human flesh and the Savior of the world, said in the Gospel of John, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Whatever the case, whatever the circumstance, the Bible reveals to us that when people encountered darkness, whether literal or figurative, God was often the source of light that they needed in that situation. Time and time again, people tried to turn to human avenues to try and find a way out of the confusion, darkness, or poor circumstances. And every time this happened, the person always ended up coming before God because of their inability to recognize his ability to conquer darkness. Today, Susan read for us a well-known passage from the book of Isaiah. Many Christians or people familiar with church have heard it before because it's often read during Advent or Christmas services. It is Isaiah, a prophet, someone commissioned by God to prepare the hearts of the world for God's plan by foretelling pieces of God's plan before they become reality. And our text today comes in along a speech that he has given concerning the nation of Israel's pending defeat at the Assyrian Empire's hands. A study of history around this time in the book of Chronicles and Kings reveals that Israel is a divided country, with separate kings ruling over the southern and the northern kingdom. And as the Assyrian Empire begins its advance, the northern kingdom and Syria merge to try and force the southern kingdom to join them to fight off the Assyrians' attack. However, instead of giving in to this pressure, the king of Israel's southern kingdom goes to the Assyrian Empire's king and plots for protection, allowing Assyria to come and to conquer the northern kingdom and its allies in exchange for peace. However, this eventually opens up the Assyrians' door to destroy Israel's southern kingdom later in time anyway. And so Israel is a mess because they have chosen to trust man's ways and man's power rather than the ways and the power of the Almighty God. And so Isaiah, a living member of the royal family, in the middle of all of this turmoil, has a vision that reveals the destruction of Israel because of their pride and arrogance. And yet in the middle of this vision, he also reveals a promise. And while darkness may be present and it may seem all-consuming, light is coming, and all of the world will have an opportunity to experience its glow. Israel will suffer destruction and defeat now, but from its royal family will come a great king, one whose kingdom will know no end and whose reign will ensure peace, justice, and righteousness and compassion for all. He will be the ultimate source of light for those that are caught up in the confusion of a dark world. He will, in a sense, be the light of the world. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? Isaiah, living in perhaps the darkest time in God's people's history, proclaimed that God would send Jesus to once and for all overcome darkness and establish a kingdom where hope, peace, joy, and love would reign, even when our world felt dark. The great Christmas hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, by Charles Wesley, says it this way in the third verse. Life and light to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lay his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the songs of earth, born to give them second birth. I don't know about you, but to me, the words of the prophet in Isaiah chapter 9 and the lyrics of Mr. Wesley's hymn resonate with my soul today. We can have joy because unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and he brings life and light and healing. All things our world is in great need of right now. This Christmas, your soul might feel like the people of Israel did when Isaiah spoke these words to them. You may feel as if there is no hope, no peace, no joy, and no love. You may think that you are surrounded by darkness and that there is no rest for your weary soul. But friend, my encouragement to you, my promise to you, is that God does not want you to live this way. He does not want you to feel closed in by darkness. He wants you to find freedom in the light that he brings to the world. And so today, you need to realize that as dark as our world is right now, God is offering you light. And God is offering you and calling you towards opportunity for two things. Number one, he's offering you opportunity to light a candle. Find peace, hope, joy, and love in our relationship with Jesus. Jesus came to earth as a baby to be a source of light for you, to be a reason that you could have joy in this life. All you have to do is say yes. Say yes to Jesus and commit to walking with him through life today. He loves you and he wants to walk with you through this life. But you've got to reach out and take his hand. If you are interested in doing this, please check the box on the online communication card and let us know. And I'll be in touch with you another day this week. The second thing that we can all do is this. After we light our own candle, we can pass that light to someone else. We can pass the light on. God is calling you to bring hope, peace, joy, and love to others by revealing the light of Christ to those in our world's darkest places. Jesus came to earth for us, but he also empowers us to go and to share his light in our world. The Bible talks about spreading light by serving as a lampstand and not hiding under a bush. It's time to let our light shine. Who do you know that needs to hear this message? Who in your sphere of influence needs a little bit of light in their life? Email them this link. Perhaps you know someone that needs a little extra help financially this Christmas. Meet that need. Or maybe you know someone that needs a plate of cookies and a front porch conversation. My encouragement to you is to be safe, but also to do it. Folks, there are many people in the world right now, even people in our own community, searching for light. They are searching for someone who can pass the light of truth to them. Today, I stand before you to say that that someone needs to be us. It needs to be this church. Just as we pass light during the singing of Silent Night, we have a responsibility to pass the light of Christ on to the rest of our community. And so how are we doing that? How are we reaching out to those who need it most? This is what God has called us to do. And this reality is what lies at the very essence of the Christmas message. God reached out to us, and in response to his great compassion for us, we reach out to others to share with them the light that we have found. This Advent and Christmas season, I hope that you will join me in proactively reaching out to others around us who need it most. More than anything, our world needs Christmas right now, but it doesn't need the presents. It doesn't need the trees. It doesn't need the candy or the cookies or even the holiday cheer. What it needs is light, the light that came into the world to save it and to set it free, the light that you and I have committed our lives to follow. And you know, I suspect that if we do this, if we carry the light to others, Christmas might end up being a lot brighter than it appears right now. Join me in prayer this morning. Lord of time and hope, we are rushing headlong into the holidays to come. We look at our calendars and our day planners and wonder, how will we get everything done in the time allotted to us before the big day arrives? We begin to panic at the thought of projects that still need to be finished, contacts that need to be made, and preparations for festivities that have only just begun. And the darkness of obsessive holiday planning threatens to overtake us, and it clouds our minds and our spirits. But you are a God of time and of light and of joy. You bring hope to us, as you always have through the voices of the great prophets, and now through the one who is to come, Jesus Christ. Remind us again what this season is truly about: love, hope, peace, and joy. Calm us down, slow us down. Help us remember that it is in loving relationship that you gave your Son to us. And it is in loving relationship that your word is carried into the hearts of the people. No tinsel, ribbons, tape, cards convey that eternal message adequately. You have given us the light to shine in our path and to cut through our darkness. Shine in the hearts of your people today. Bless those dear ones whom we have named before you today, who need healing, who need reconciling and comforting presence and love. Give strength to all who face difficult situations, and let your compassionate light shine on them, guiding their decisions and their steps. Bring us at last to your presence, where the light of hope and love continually pour out on us. These prayers and hopes we offer in confidence and gratitude for your love and presence. We ask all these things in the name of your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. But lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Yes.
And now, friends, may the light of the Advent season shine in your hearts. May it shine on your path and beckon you to God's love and service to the world. Go in peace, and may the God of peace go with you. Amen.